Me atrevo a pensar que es esta realidad descomunal, y no solo su expresión literaria, la que este año ha merecido la atención de la Academia Sueca de las Letras. Una realidad que no es la del papel, sino que vive con nosotros y determina cada instante de nuestras incontables muertes cotidianas, y que sostenta un manantial de creación insaciable, pleno de desdicha y de belleza, del cual este colombiano errante y nostálgico no es más que una cifra más señalada por la suerte.
It was in the impressionistic art age of the late 19th century that artists truly began to distinguish between representing a sensory realism, that is, how we see or hear the world, and representing the experience of the world, the way our perception of reality is moderated by experience, history, culture, language, religion, trauma, and more. This question of what reality is, whether there can be such a thing as an objective, material reality outside of our perception of it, was given critical language by Jacques Derrida in the 1960s, plunging the literary, linguistic, and critical worlds into the chaos of deconstruction.
Avant d'essayer de répondre à cette question, je voudrais faire une remarque préliminaire sur le caractère totalement artificiel de cette situation. Je ne sais pas qui regardera ce que nous sommes en train de filmer ou d'enregistrer, mais je voudrais souligner, au lieu de les effacer, ces conditions techniques. Ne pas feindre la naturalité là où elle n'existe pas. J'ai déjà commencé à répondre à votre question sur la déconstruction, parce qu'un des gestes de la déconstruction consiste en particulier à ne pas naturaliser, à ne pas faire comme si ce qui n'est pas naturel était naturel, comme si ce qui est conditionné par l'histoire, par la technique, par l'institution, par la société, était une donnée naturelle.
For postmodernist writers like Thomas Pynchon and John Barth in the 1960s, the immateriality of reality and the failure of language as a representational tool, as proven by Derrida, would lead to a literature of anxiety, paranoia, and aesthetic solipsism. For others, though, Derrida's deconstructive approach didn't destroy their concept of reality. Rather, it destabilized a dominant Eurocentric Enlightenment model of reality that didn't allow for alternative approaches.
Our troubled time. It is time for all Americans to take control of their own lives and stop being pushed around and poisoned. The race for nuclear superiority can only end with the destruction of civilization.
Up through the 1990s, readings of magical realist writings like 100 Years of Solitude by Gabriel Garcia Marquez suggested that they should be classified and interpreted as postmodern texts. However, when we turn to 21st century works of magical realism, such as Karente Yamashita's Tropic of Orange and Mohsin Hamid's Exit West, we are offered new tools for understanding this genre. With these tools in hand, we can return to Marquez with a profoundly different understanding than his American contemporaries approached him with. In order to speak on this genre and its shifting understanding between the 20th and 21st centuries, we must first define several terms. This work of defining will itself begin to reveal to us certain misunderstandings about Marquez and Latin American magical realism that have been unfortunately concretized into modern definitions. Magical realism was a term first coined by Franz Roh in 1925, applied to European post-impressionist paintings return to and reshaping of figural representation. Most critics, including Roh himself, have since distanced Roh's conceptualization of magical realism from the literary term, Rowe himself clarified that he was not speaking of magical realism as a mode with specters, ghosts, or, quote, religious psychological figures, quote. Rather, he was interested in capturing the way objects and materials of reality can themselves be magical to us, can be imbued with a power beyond their own material reality. This was a rejection of the increasing interest in abstraction in impressionistic artwork. This will be important for us when thinking about whether Marquez's writing itself is filled with the religious psychological, or whether, indeed, Rowe's definition can be aptly applied to Marquez's world. Rowe's term was picked up and applied to the world of surrealism, both art and literature. It began to be applied to writers in the surrealist and dadaist circles. Leonora Carrington comes to mind. It wasn't until 1967 that Elio Carpentier would rather aggressively distinguish between the magical realism influenced by the European surrealist movement and the magical realist writing of Latin America, what Carpentier coined as the marvelous real. Carpentier defines the marvelous real as, quote, an unexpected alteration of reality, the miracle, from a privileged revelation of reality, an unaccustomed insight that is singularly favored by an unexpected richness of reality or an amplification of the scale and the categories of reality, perceived with particular intensity by virtues of an exaltation of the spirit that leads it to a kind of extreme state. End quote. Carpentier was critical of the surrealist movement in that he believed its artists, quote, invoke ghosts without believing that they answer to incantations, end quote, and cannot, quote, conceive of a valid mysticism, end quote. Notice that Carpentier's term sees the marvelous as a richness or amplification of reality, and doesn't distinguish between the objective reality and the magical or marvelous means of perceiving it. Magical realist texts of the 20th century were usually categorized for their inclusion of something labeled unreal. Ghosts, alterations of the scientific truth of existence, unraveling of conventional trajectories of space and time, etc. However, neither Rowe nor Carpentier distinguished between the real and the magical or marvelous. Rather, they both see them as part of the real. It will also be helpful for us to define what it means for a work of literature to be postmodern. This term is usefully exemplified in a list by critic Ihab Hassan, which includes anti-form, play, anarchy, exhaustion and silence, deconstruction, schizophrenia, irony, and indeterminacy as defining factors of the movement. Other critics categorize postmodernism by its metafiction, its satire, and its self-referential concern with the text as an unstable object itself. Carpentier establishes, and Marquez affirms, the uses of magical realism as better interpreting history in the continental Americas for, quote, after all, what is the history of America if not a chronicle of the marvelous real, end quote. Similarly, Marquez described his writing as the unbridled reality of Latin American history and contemporary existence, rising from the, quote, crucial problem, a lack of conventional means to render our lives believable, end quote. Salman Rushdie, in speaking on Marquez, provides a perhaps more useful distinction between magical realism and naturalism.
Case of the greatest in the context of world literature, too. And in a minute, I want to discuss the links between magic realism and other literature from other lands that also moves beyond the borders of naturalism. But to do this is not to diminish the singularity of the artist. And the singularity of García Márquez lies, I believe, in the precise note he strikes, a note somewhere on the scale between sweetness and bitterness, between a gentle acceptance of one's fate and an anger about it. The wrath of the imagination, he calls it, from which note proceeds the music of solitude, of human beings locked alone in destinies they cannot escape, moving towards deaths foretold.
Naturalism was a literary movement applying the scientific method and Enlightenment notions of objective observation to fiction. While realism moves towards representing all that is experienced, naturalism instead represents all that can be observed. This distinction would better serve us in understanding the type of realism Marquez was utilizing, not necessarily one of the observable world, but one of the experienced world. Although Rushdie helps us with this distinction, he remains utterly 20th century in his understanding of Marquez's magical realism, perceiving the magical elements as symbols and metaphors rather than reality themselves.
In William Faulkner's Yoknapatofa, R.K. Narayan's Malgudi, and yes, the Macondo of Gabriel Garcia Marquez, imagination is used to enrich reality, not escape from it. The wonderful has deep roots in the real, and for that reason, is able to use the surreal to create metaphors and images of the real that come to feel more real than reality, more truthful than the truth. In this famous passage from 100 Years of Solitude, something utterly fantastic is happening. The dead man's blood acquires a purpose, almost a life of its own, and moves methodically through the streets of Macondo until it comes to rest at his mother's feet. The blood's behavior is impossible. Yet the passage reads as truthful. The journey of the blood feels like the journey of the news of his death, from the room where he shot himself to his mother's kitchen, and its arrival at the feet of the matriarch Ursula Iguaran reads as high tragedy. A mother learns that her son is dead.
Rushdie's own fervid atheism prevents him from making any of the kinds of metaphysical leaps that Marquez was making in his depiction of reality. The problem of this Western view of Marquez's magical realism, and here I include Salman Rushdie, who despite being born in Bombay and having a useful critical eye for Indian life, moved away from India when he was 7, and has since lived in the United Kingdom and the United States. The problem is this difficulty in accepting Marquez's notion of what is real. This view is articulated by Scott Simpkins' concept of the supplement. According to Simpkins, magical realist texts use, quote, supplementation to improve upon the realistic text, end quote. Simpkins uses the example of the insomnia plague from 100 Years of Solitude as a model of, quote, a supplemental strategy that may enhance, through its own theatricality, the force of an otherwise commonplace development, end quote. He later supposes that the goal of magical realism is, quote, to return our focus to the backdrop of textual reality, its production and function, by defamiliarizing it, end quote. This viewpoint on magical realism is hopelessly European, providing little room for a non-Western understanding of these fraught terms, reality, magic, and experience. A reading of the events of Macondo that see the magic occurring in that fabled village as being a supplement to the reality that is being portrayed assumes that the experience of the real in Macondo in Latin America is the same as the experience of the real in Auburn, Alabama. Similarly, in Theo Dehaene's analysis, there is the eccentric, operating as a way to correct existing notions of reality. This, too, places Eurocentric conceptions of the real as the focal point, and magical realism as responding to this tradition, rather than acknowledging that it is operating with its own logic of realness. Let's turn to Simpkins' own example of the insomnia plague from 100 Years of Solitude. As the insomnia plague sweeps through the town, it is accompanied by a gathering amnesia, a loss of the names of things and memories of what once was. To combat this, everything in the town is labeled, so, quote, thus they went on living in a reality that was slipping away, momentarily captured by words, but which would escape irremediably when they forgot the values of the written letters, end quote. Now, my Western notion of medicine, biology, and cognitive science won't allow me to accept as natural reality the notion that an entire village can pass through months of insomnia and thus lose their minds. I am tempted to approach this scene in the same way Simpkins does, or Rushdie might. But what happens when we read this scene as if it is reality? What kind of reality does this scene depict? Having recently lived through the COVID pandemic, some aspects of this plague are immediately recognizable, like how, quote, no one was alarmed at first. On the contrary, they were happy at not sleeping because there was so much to do in Macondo in those days that there was barely enough time. They worked so hard that soon they had nothing else to do, and they could be found at 3 o'clock in the morning with their arms crossed, counting the notes and the waltz of the clock, end quote. While the world went into lockdowns, we witnessed a burst of creative energy. Gardens, sourdough starters, journaling, write that novel. Activity which quickly became replaced by self-help guidance, assuring us that just because we were home all the time did not mean we needed to expect wonders from ourselves. Instead, we would gather together to converse endlessly. In our world on Zoom, in Macondo, in the streets. The reality of living through a plague does not look that much different in Marquez's depiction than our own reality. Indeed, the combination of the pandemic and new advances in social media like TikTok are leading us toward a plague of insomnia. According to a May 2020 poll, Americans reported that due to the pandemic lockdowns, 67% of respondents had less healthy sleep than before the pandemic, and 52% are sleeping less than before. Additionally, it is not whimsical magic or fancy to link insomnia and memory together. Research across the 20th and 21st century has demonstrably linked memory formation to neural sleep activity. In all these examples, however, I am still using my own European model of understanding experience and reality, not Marquez's own model. Let us return to the noble speech, in which Marquez articulates a different notion of experience.
Pues si estas dificultades nos entorpecen a nosotros, que somos de su esencia, no es difícil entender que los talentos racionales de este lado del mundo, extasiados en la contemplación de sus propias culturas, se hayan quedado sin un método válido para interpretarnos. Es comprensible que insistan en medirnos con la misma vara con que se miden a sí mismos, sin recordar que los estragos de la vida no son iguales para todos y que la búsqueda de la identidad propia es tan ardua y sangrienta para nosotros como lo fue para ellos. La interpretación de nuestra realidad con esquemas ajenos solo contribuye a hacernos cada vez más desconocidos, cada vez menos libres, cada vez más solitarios.
What reality or real experience does this insomnia plague portray? Let's abstract out to the sensations of the experience. Quote, hallucinated lucidity, quote, the nostalgia of dreams, quote, the loss of memory, and quote, an imagined reality, end quote. What is most useful about these aspects of the insomnia plague is not that they reflect some metaphorical magic by which we can supplement our understanding of reality, but instead how they draw attention to how many parts of what is supposedly reality are themselves as magical as not sleeping for months on end. Leah Mogford Spence subverts the expectations that the world of the insomnia plague belongs to the magical, while the world of history belongs to the real. In her reading of the banana plantation strikes, Mogford Spence points out how, quote, history and historiography are powered by performative magic too, end quote. Portions of these events, suggesting that the plantation had no workers, suggesting that there were no deaths in the slaughter of the 3,000 Jose Arcadio Segundo witnesses, takes on the element of magic Simpkins describes as supplemental to reality in the insomnia plague, but are actually historically documented events. Thus, according to Mogford Spence, there is, quote, no definitive means of separating supplemental magic from original realism, history from fiction, or original from representation, end quote. By demonstrating the sleight of hand that has been used to document the legal cases brought against the non-fictional United Fruit Company, Marquez refutes eurocentric readings of his text as operating with a magic and real binary system of interpreting experience. Indeed, Marquez announces this in the first chapter of his book. When faced for the first time with a block of ice, José Arcadio Buendía declares, quote, "This is the great invention of our time," end quote. Something which is a naturally occurring phenomena, born from the weather systems and chemical states of existence, was labeled by Buendía to instead be an invention. Buendia, whose model of thinking incidentally is contrasted from Ursula's spiritual, magical belief system as being somehow more rational. Once again, Marquez is reminding me, as a Eurocentric white reader, that my pre-existing notions of what is real and what is imagined, what is natural and what is invented, cannot apply to a cultural concept of experience that doesn't expect or require these distinctions from the world. Leah Mogford Spence, in describing the way Marquez takes the documented historical reality and manifests it into magical unreality, speaks of how, quote, a performative utterance conjures that which it names, end quote. Thus, declarations of reality manifest the reality we live in, regardless of whether we can actually ascertain the material realness of what has been declared. I'm reminded of RuPaul's description of true drag that, quote, true drag has to do with seeing that this world is an illusion, and that everything that you say you are and everything it says that you are on your driver's license, it's all an illusion. Most people will never in their lives understand what that is, because they don't have the operating system to understand that duality, end quote. Karen Tae Yamashita's Tropic of Orange does just this same work of demonstrating how illusory what we believe to be real actually is.
On the other hand, I think there's a kind of truth about creative limitations in our freedom, and about how to cultivate imagination, and then when you cultivate it, what to do with it. And so I guess these are ethical questions. Mm-hmm. But however, within the prison of this camp, imagination really becomes necessary. That is, in order to be in camp, you have to imagine your freedom in order to, it's the only way to have it.
Archangel, a mystic, ageless, formerly winged, incomprehensibly strong man or a deity or being in Yamashita's novel, has the capacity to pull a bus heading from Mexico across the border and to Los Angeles, using rings of his own flesh to hoist the vehicle. In pulling this bus north, Archangel finds himself pulling the border itself. Quote, the great multitude behind pushed it for him, pushed it and its passengers and the little boy sitting on his suitcase with the orange, pushed the tropic ever northward. End quote. The lines by which we have demarcated the border between the U.S. and Mexico have been moved by the movement of the people following Archangel, for, quote, earth has become soft again, end quote. Archangel is leading the people toward Los Angeles, which he describes as, quote, the second largest city in Mexico, end quote. Geopolitical reality would tell us that Los Angeles is not in Mexico. The legalese of immigration's reality would tell us that a border has not moved because of the movement of people. The reality of geography and history would argue the impossibility of a man's, quote, body fastened to an entire continent, end quote. But Yamashita insists we ask, then, what, according to these disciplines, is a border? There's no material reality to our border, despite the Trump administration's border wall and Governor Greg Abbott's floating barbed wire in the Rio Grande. Our border is the distinction of treaties, historical handshakes from a previous century, which is, quote, a naming which produces, end quote, as Mogford Spence describes it. A space of dust and soil is named by a paper that has nothing to do with Archangel and his followers' lives, and this then manifests their identities as legal or illegal immigrants, residents, temporary workers, asylum seekers, refugees, and others. Ruth Hsu asks us, quote, how is space produced but in the imagining of it and in living as we imagine, end quote. If magical realism is designed to be an imagined reality that somehow distinguishes itself from historical, geographical, political, cultural, or social reality, Yamashita reminds us that much of that reality is imagined as well. And Mei Yi Janssen defines these as, quote, imposed borders, end quote. Thank you. Magical realism appears to be called on often when conventional modes of realism are insufficient in describing lived experience. This is evident in Mohsin Hamid's Exit West. As Brian Yazel points out, migrancy unfolds within a global network of institutions and phenomena that shape any individual migrant story, end quote. In Hamid's novel, the first act of migration, done using doors that have become open portals that connect countries in crisis with countries that are comparatively stable, this first occurs in, quote, the glow of her computer charger and wireless router, end quote, a refugee passing from their home country into Surrey Hills, Australia, an alarmed house in a wealthy neighborhood owned by a white couple. The travel of the refugee, usually hidden in the American or European imagination by the expanse of the desert and the ocean, occurs now in the context of the internet, race, class, capitalism, and security. Yazel begins by telling us that, quote, migration cannot be adequately represented simply by portraying individuals moving across borders, end quote. Naturalism is insufficient in portraying reality. The experience of migration can only be portrayed through the implementation of what our Eurocentric brains term unreal or magical in order for us to enter the surreal and, quote, awesome reality, end quote, Marquez described to us earlier.
We have become so focused on the story of how somebody crosses the border. You know, how did you cross the Mediterranean in a small boat? Or how did you cross the US-Mexico border, crawl underneath a barbed wire? And we think that people who've done that are different from us. It makes us imagine that that's all their life consisted of, and that's very different from us. But once you take away that part of their story, you are left with people who are just like us, actually, that any of us can have this experience. And so hopefully, taking away that part of the story doesn't minimize the importance in the real world that happens, but reminds us that that's not what makes these people who they are. They are people just like us.
When Hamid's migrants make their way to these new countries, they establish new communities, new forms of self-government, new forms of self-sustaining, alternatives to the cash economy, etc. Once again, conventionally fixed notions of capitalism, government, safety, are destabilized when a magical realist text draws our attention to how immaterial they really are.
We are the buying power. If we can just teach each other to circulate our dollars within the community, we will solve our own problems. We are literally the answer to our own problems, but we have to change our thinking and come together.
What is really the magic in Exit West? Is it that doors become portals that transverse geographical bounds? Or is the possibility of cultural insulation, native mentality, and closed borders, themselves a myth Yamashita has already dispersed for us, itself the portion of this book that may feel unreal to the Eurocentric reader? It cannot be ignored that predominantly white readers of 20th century magical realism failed to grasp the way the genre dismantled Eurocentric models of realness, while 21st century non-white novelists find this other way of being so comfortable. Ramon Saldivar, who examines the literature of the early 2000s through a post-race lens, describes how, quote, race should not be understood as an attribute of personal identity, but rather as a complex set of personal and social actions, a structure of doing. We might say the same thing about this aesthetic of realness, that it is not interested in inherent or static claims about existence, but that existence is something done, it is experiential, and our literature should capture the experience of reality and not just the sensory data that constitutes one aspect of it. Perez and Chevalier recognize similar compulsions in magical realism, that as a genre it, quote, calls for the reimagining of experience beyond categories associated with traditional ideas of being by calling attention to difference and multiplicity, end quote. Reality is an experience lived by an experiencing being, not dictated. In assessing the aesthetics of U.S. post-race literature, Saldivar asks, quote, how can one write the history of the future? What are the conditions of a style appropriate to representing future that do not and may never exist? End quote. This question of time is an important one in understanding how readings of Marquez from the 20th century failed in ways that 21st century readings might not. Chevalier and Perez also discuss how, quote, Earlier readings of magic tilt toward the past, revealing traumatic histories obscured by the normalizing projects of realism, end quote. This is certainly true of Marquez's depiction of the banana company protests, the way in which the reality of the lived experience was co-opted by official narratives and the tools of data and information to blur the full truth. Perez and Chevalier hypothesize that magical realism of the 21st century isn't designed to rectify the past, but instead, quote, as the expansion of being, beckoning us toward the potential of a more just and imaginative future, end quote. Can we return to Marquez again and find in it the future as well as the past? Certainly. It is history which informs each act of the Buendia family, and it is its own history that consumes it. In the final pages, in what postmodern critics may have been misinterpreting as a typically postmodern metafictional gesture, the last of the Buendia family deciphers the ancient parchments of the mystic figure Melchiades and discovers that, quote, it was the history of the family written by Melchiades, down to the most trivial details, 100 years ahead of time, end quote. As Aureliano reads what we now recognize as this very book, 100 Years of Solitude, here in our own hands, he gets closer to the current moment. As he goes, quote, the wind began, warm, incipient, full of voices from the past, the most tenacious nostalgia. Its cyclonic strength tore the doors and windows off their hinges, end quote. The act of reading one's own exact history becomes itself an act of destruction. The nostalgia of obsessing over one's own past eliminates the opportunity for looking to the future. Every act Aureliano takes is being documented, so he cannot possibly progress beyond the act of reading the act of reading the act of reading the act. The attempt to discover oneself by looking backwards is what consumes the family, quote, as if he were looking into a speaking mirror. Everything written on them was unrepeatable since time immemorial and forevermore, because races condemned to 100 years of solitude did not have a second opportunity on earth, end quote. It would be an abject failure to read the end of Solitude and not recognize in it the bitter warning against nostalgia, against the hand-wringing obsession with the past that prevents any sort of understanding of the future. Marquez may not offer a potential future, but he certainly admonishes his characters, his readers, and his fellow citizens for their inability to step past the boundaries of nostalgia. It is in this, then, that there may be the most significant distinction between the magical realism of Marquez's mid-20th century and the magical realism of this early 21st century moment. Not history, not notions of reality, not notions of identity, but notions of utopia. When Yamashita's universe in Tropic of Orange reaches its complete decay, time begins to dissolve, myth and reality dissolve, geographically bounded space dissolves. One character, Buzzworm, tunes into his ever-present radio signal and hears, quote, one big love song. I love you. You love me. I love myself. We love us. We love the world. We love God. We love ourselves but hate some of you. I hate myself but would love you with, end quote. When a freak accident shuts down the highway and folks are forced to abandon their cars, a new society of the houseless moves into them, builds their own non-capitalist system of exchange, entertainment, and care. As they do so, the other significant geographic event occurs. Quote, can't you see it? Where we are, Harbor Freeway? It's growing, stretched this way and that. In fact, this whole business from Pico Union on one side to East LA, his this side, and South Central over there, it's pushing out. Damn if it's not growing into everything, end quote. It's as if the lifestyle being constructed there, the non-hostile takeover of the freeway by the most ejected and rejected of society, is changing the ground beneath them, is too big to be contained by the space it inhabits. Yamashita's utopian vision doesn't occur in the violent battle with NAFTA, a representative of all that is toxic about the global capitalist empire, but instead here in the way alternatives to that empire are constructed without necessarily a promise of a future, but with a full commitment that defies geographic reasoning. Utopia exists for some for a fleeting moment. So too does Hamid construct a utopian possibility in Exit West. As refugees take up residence in London, New York, and other relatively stable spaces, there's the threat of violent ejection. In the same way that we hear horror stories of Border Patrol officers pushing migrant children back into the river and making it impossible for them to receive humanitarian aid, quote, natives, end quote, in Hamid's cities begin violent uprisings against the new refugee populations. However, this violence never blooms into the all-out warfare expected. Instead, quote, decency on this occasion won out, and bravery, for courage is demanded not to attack when afraid, end quote. For critic Iwak Kowal, it is precisely the utopian vision of contemporary magical realist texts that challenge our conventional notions of reality for, quote, Hamid's formally realist vision of a resolution to the migrant crisis, which can be seen as fantastical and even magical because it is optimistic and thus, for many readers, unrealistic, end quote. What magic allows writers like Hamid and Yamashita to do is to transgress the boundaries of bitterness and cynicism that grows from the captured horrors in social realism in favor of projecting a possible future, a utopia, a potential, quote, a future where violence loses its grip on our capacity to be, end quote. In his Literature of Replenishment, John Barth claims Marquez's 100 Years of Solitude as a seminal postmodern text. What is postmodern about it to him is, quote, the synthesis of straightforwardness and artifice, realism and magic and myth, political passion and non-political artistry, characterization and caricature, humor and terror, end quote. In doing so, however, Barth fails to enumerate the way Marquez and magical realism as a genre in general was repudiating other aspects inherent to the postmodern movement. Satire and irony manipulated to avoid moral responsibility, a lack of ethics, a passivity in the face of immorality. Instead, magical realism engenders a sense of justice, a suspicion of history that leads to a reaching forward, the question of the utopian and of consequence. If I, as a white, U.S., Western-trained, English-speaking, male author can allow my notion of reality to relax enough that the hegemony of sensory data can coexist with all the other, potentially metaphysical, certainly incomprehensible aspects of reality, then I, like Yamashita and Hamid, might be able to imagine a future reality that contains what I would once have named impossible, but now recognize as already present, unnamed, and magic.
I want to have kids more than just about anything. I want them to grow up in a world that's kind. And I know people laugh at that. They call you a vulnerable snowflake and an idealist. But I always come back to the question, why? I understand that it's complex, but at the same time, it's really simple. Why can't we change? Why can't we be kind?